Jack. This is Boomer Life on CIAL 650.
The best things in life are free, but you can give them to the birds and bees.
Welcome to Boomer Life on CIAL 650. I'm George Gordon. Today we're asking, are you where you want to be financially? Well thought out plan for your financial future is an important part of building the life you want for you and your family. Today we're talking with Jim Doyle, Senior Financial Consultant with the Investors Financial Services Incorporated, about that taboo subject, money. And it's okay, you can let the kids come back into the room.
You know, for many families, money can be a hard thing to talk about, okay? And the future is daunting. It keeps us up at night. A U.S. survey of over 1,000 adults by creditcards.com said that 65% said they lose sleep worrying about their finances. Understandably, topping the list was healthcare, followed by 37% being concerned about saving enough for retirement, and fully 25% lie awake worrying that they won't be able to pay their mortgages.
Sounds like a good recipe for financial insomnia.
Luckily, an even more significant number of people have been inspired to act, with 82% of respondents losing sleep saying that they took at least one step to improve their finances, chiefly from reducing expenses, selling unused items, or taking a second job.
I guess it starts with that first step, eh?
The most important thing you can do, if you feel out of control, is to take some sort of action, even if it's small. Moves like making a budget or selling something may not seem significant, but they can make you feel more empowered, and that can help you sleep more soundly at night.
All right. Let's say our listeners want to go a step further. Other than calling you, of course, to get started, what else would you suggest?
Contribute to a registered retirement savings account or a TFSA, a tax-free savings account. You know, if your TFSA is sitting in cash, maybe it's time to consider whether it should be invested. If you've already got a regular savings program going, ask yourself if it's time to give yourself a raise in your savings effort. Have you set a targeted savings rate?
So pay yourself first. That's a pretty powerful suggestion.
You know, I love the idea of trying to save the equivalent of 1 hour's work each day. You know, if you can't start there, consider a smaller amount with the goal of gradually increasing your regular savings until you can get to your target.
All right. Planning, targets, how much should people be trying to save?
Well, everyone's savings goals might be based on their personal needs. But as a rule of thumb, and I'm going to say this lacking in, of course, any other plans, 10% is a figure that we like to suggest. It's the easiest way to stay on your finances is to set up everything once, okay, and then let it run on autopilot from there. This means establishing automatically monthly contributions to your RRSPs or TFSAs. Not only will you save and invest hands-free, but you won't even miss the money because you won't even see it.
So I guess what's key here is you don't need to be rich to get started. What do you say to those who have trouble getting started, though?
One of the challenges we sometimes see is the tendency for people to separate their money into separate accounts based on a variety of subjective criteria, like the source of the money and intent for each account. Unfortunately, this can lead to a conflicted approach to savings and investing.
Now, I think a lot of people use mental accounting, although they may not see it as such. Why is this an issue?
Well, let's consider the case of someone who has a special money jar or fund set aside for a vacation or a new home while still carrying substantial credit card debt.
Sounds like the money in the special fund is being treated differently from the money that same person is using to pay down his or her debt.
Yeah. You know, diverting funds from your debt repayment increases interest payments and reduces the person's net worth.
So what I'm hearing, again, simply put, it's not logical, perhaps even detrimental, to having savings in a jar earning little to no interest. Meanwhile, you're carrying credit card debt and charging 15% annually.
You know, in this case, rather than saving for a holiday, the most logical course of action would be to use the funds in the jar to pay off the expensive debt.
Even if they can't afford the vacation, that's going to be hard to hear.
You know, it might come down to how you view money and what are your values associated with it. For instance, People may want to feel that money saved for a new house or for their car fund is too important to relinquish. As a result, this important account may not even be touched at all, okay? Or even though it might provide some additional financial benefit.
Any other examples?
Well, here's a real-life example, okay? Imagine you've got a weekly lunch budget, and you're going to spend or buy a sandwich for $6 for lunch, okay? As you're waiting in line, one of the following occurred. One, you find to have a hole in your pocket, and you've lost the $6. Two, you buy the sandwich, but as you take a bite, you stumble, and your sandwich ends up on the floor. In either case, assuming you had the money, would you buy another sandwich?
Well, logically speaking, your answer in both scenarios should be the same. I'd spend the $6 and buy the sandwich.
Most people in the first scenario wouldn't consider the lost money to be part of their lunch budget because the money hadn't yet been spent. They're more likely to buy another sandwich, whereas in the second scenario, the money had already been spent.
Jim, I'd like that you're bringing our attention to the importance of looking at how we frame and view our money decisions.
People can also treat their money differently depending on its source. And we see this one a lot more than you'd expect.
How so?
Well, consider the case of found money, such as a tax return, or gifts, or even inheritances.
Even inheritances?
Well, especially inheritances. People can treat money differently if it comes from their own paychecks versus another source.
So far, we've been talking about how we treat money differently depending on its purpose or its source. It's a great reminder that the value of working with a financial professional can get you so much further ahead. Thank you so much for this valuable reminder that financial habits, as much as investment performance, can determine your financial successes.
Let me ask if you've ever found yourself in this situation. Dividing your investments between a safe investment portfolio and a speculative portfolio in order to prevent the negative returns from affecting the entire portfolio. Essentially, you have two masters, and you may not be serving either of them very well.
A lot of things that we can't control, like stock market returns, tax rates, or unexpected events. So when it comes to financial planning, what areas do we have the most control over?
Of all of the areas in financial planning that we probably have the highest degree of control over are our income, expenses, and savings, making it extremely important to create a workable budget. It's important to understand that the budget is only one element of financial planning. Successful planning requires positive cash flow. And looking at your average monthly income and expenses so that you can see what's left over to help create your budget and your plan.
Well, I'm hearing you. Look, if we've managed in our family to do a pretty good job up to this point without a budget, you know, like a really well-mapped out plan. Why is it, though, it's so essential to create that budget?
You need positive cash flow in order to save long-term. You also need to know what you've got coming in and what you've got going out to live the good life that you want.
So where do we start?
Well, set goals and priorities that you want to achieve. Look at resources, what you've got, okay, and what it's going to take to get you there. That includes looking at your income and expenses over the past year, as well as assets and debts. And regularly track where you are financially through an ongoing evolution of your plan and the strategies that keep your plan relevant and effective.
And this is where the help of an advisor can be invaluable. Do you find yourself stressed out about money matters? Chances are you're not alone. Everybody wants to be on the road to comfortable retirement. But knowing how to get there is a different story. Now, you're listening to Boomer Life on CL 650. I'm George Gordon today, talking with Jim Doyle, Senior Financial Consultant with the Investors Group. If you're feeling unsettled during these conversations, I do encourage you to talk to Jim and his team, explore what steps you can take to help improve your financial picture. Jim can be reached at 604-682-5431, or you can email him at jimdoyle@investorsgroup.com. When we come back, we're going to hear more about planning challenges and the pitfalls that you might face as your family's chief financial officer. You might want to consider or start to consider your tax and estate planning strategies. That's next on Boomer Life.
Celebrating the Boomer lifestyle. This is Boomer Life on CL 650.